I encourage you this morning to turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 4. I'll be reading the first 11 verses with you this morning. It's a joy to be with you, to open the Word of God with you on this special day. The passage we'll be reading this morning falls immediately after the baptism of our Lord and the majestic announcement from heaven that the Father is delighted in the Son. Right after the Holy Spirit descended on Jesus in power, he then led our Lord to be tested or tempted in the wilderness. Matthew 4, beginning at verse 1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Be gone, Satan. It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. This is God's word. Let us turn to him in prayer. Gracious Father, we come to you this morning with open hearts and open minds, eager to receive your word. Will you help us by your Holy Spirit? For while we come ready, we also come weak and foolish and sinful. Father, we ask that we would see today how in our weakness our Savior is strong, how in our foolishness he is wise, how in our sin that he is our holiness and righteousness and all of our hope. Will you answer these prayers? We know that you will, because we come to you in the Spirit's power and in your Son's name, the one in whom you are well pleased. Amen. The passage that we've read is one of the most puzzling in the New Testament, easily the most puzzling in Matthew. Satan boldly confronting the Son of God about God's provision in verses 1 to 4 when he tempts Jesus to take the easy way out of hardship. Satan asking Jesus to try on presumption in verses 5 to 7 where he dares Jesus to live carelessly and presume upon God's graciousness. And then the final idea, the ultimate perversion of priorities that we see in verses 8 to 11, when Satan madly suggests that he could give Jesus complete dominion in a moment if only the Creator would bow to the creature. These strange otherworldly confrontations between God the Son and God the and Satan the corrupt angel raise questions which we will not even begin to discuss this morning. Nonetheless, there's so much to learn from this account. In fact, in reading about the testing of God's Son Jesus, there's almost no limit to the number of lessons that we can learn. I don't want to say there's a moral to the story. There's 1,000 morals to this story, this history. Bishop J.C. Ryle, the Bishop of Liverpool in the 19th century, mentioned some of these lessons, and his comments are often very helpful. First, he says, "What a real and mighty enemy we have in the devil. He is not afraid to assault even the Lord Jesus himself." You'll know as well as I know that today people consider Satan to be a joke. They talk about demons and devils lightly. He's a kind of cartoon character to them. In truth, he is a serious enemy. And that's because, in the second place, if Satan is this bold with Christ, will he not be equally, even more bold, in fact, with Christians? I think we see that in our lives, don't we? Are you ever tempted to entertain unloving thoughts about others? Do you struggle with putting away dark desires that discourage you? Do you have shameful memories that get replayed in your mind? They keep coming back. Well, there's a reason for this. We have an enemy, and he's often tempting us to sin or trying to convince us we cannot avoid sin. He spreads lies. And we must know in advance how to deal with his temptations, especially those that we face regularly. Ryle says, there's no enemy worse than an enemy who's never seen and never dies. Let us remember every day that if we would be saved, we must not only crucify the flesh and overcome the world, but also resist the devil. Third, and this is one of these things so obvious that you wouldn't have missed it, but so important that I need to say it anyway. The whole purpose of Satan's temptations is to get us to sin against God. This business of temptation is very personal for Satan. He hates God, and he wants all things to work for the harm of those who love God. He's always trying to displease his Creator. That's why he tempts us to deny sin, ignore sin, excuse sin, perhaps persuade us that we can handle sin, but above all wants us to commit sin. And that's what makes sin so serious. This is why the angels in hell rejoice when we argue in our kitchens, when we're reckless as we drive to church, when we don't mind what we see on our screens, when we're not wise in evaluating our friendships. It's because he wants us to sin that we are to be wise to him, to his temptations, that we're to band together as God's people, to be honest with each other, pray for one another, and pray especially that we not be led into temptation. Fourth, we should remember in our temptations that the one in whom we trust and in whose name we pray knows what it's like to be tempted. The writer to the Hebrews may have been reflecting on this passage when he reminds us that Jesus was tempted in all things like we are. Jesus can identify with us. He understands us. We can be honest with him, pour out our hearts to him. He has fought against sin, and he knows our deepest struggles and what we need. I wish everyone in the church already owned and operated a J.C. Ryle's Expository Thoughts on the Gospels, a wonderful tribute exposition on the four Gospels. If you did, I could just say volume 1, page 27, and you could go home and read it. But because I'm not confident of that, I'm going to quote Ryle just one last time. He has this to say. Are we ever tempted by Satan to distrust God's care and goodness? So is Jesus. Are we ever tempted to presume on God's mercy and run into danger without warrant? So also was Jesus. Are we ever tempted to commit one great private sin for the sake of some great seeming advantage? So also was Jesus. Are we ever tempted to listen to some misapplication of Scripture as an excuse for doing something wrong? So also was Jesus. He is just the Savior that a tempted people require. A few moments ago, I mentioned that it's not enough to say there's a moral to the story because there's so many lessons for us to learn. It's also not enough for us to say there's a moral to the story because there's a profound point and a major connection here in this passage. In fact, these 11 verses remain one of the most important connections between the Old Testament and the New. Let me explain what I mean. If you know the first gospel well, you will remember that the infant Jesus was rushed to Egypt for a time to escape the clutches of evil King Herod. Matthew also explains back in chapter 2 that that was a fulfillment of a prophecy made by Hosea. Just as God's chosen son, Israel, would come up out of Egypt, so too God's son, Jesus, would come up out of Egypt. Now, Jesus coming up out of Egypt in Matthew chapter 2 sets the stage for Jesus in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4. Not only is Jesus like Israel and going down to and coming up from Egypt, he's also like Israel and that he's tested in the wilderness. You see, Jesus was living out the life of Israel in a compressed or compacted form. The same things are there, but they're squished together. Some time ago, we had visitors to our home, and we learned that they were collecting socks, preferably in pairs, to send them to a place where people needed more warm clothing. And their car was full, so my wife lent them one of those vacuum bags, plastic bags. You stuff things into it, and then you attach the hose, and everything gets shrunk down into a highly compacted form. That's not a great analogy, I'll admit, but in a way somewhat similar, key moments in the history of Israel were being shrunk down and being relived in the life of Jesus. If you read the Old Testament regularly and you know what is written, you'll spot some parallel lines running through these Old and New Testament events. The Israelites were in the wilderness. Jesus was in the wilderness. They spent 40 years there. Jesus spent 40 days there. They were tempted by hunger. Jesus was tempted by a most intense hunger. You can see how these scenes belong together. Piecing these Old and New Testament events together, it's a bit like finding a painting in the attic that you discover was supposed to be a pair with the one hanging in your dining room. They go together. And when you bring the two together, you begin to see not only the similarities, but also the contrasts. The Israelites wanted God to give them food in the rocky desert. They almost demanded a miracle. Jesus was asked to turn stones to bread, but he refused. Jesus would face hunger like the Israelites, but not complain, not demand a miracle, not even work one in his own mighty power. Israel was tested and they failed. Sometimes they complained. Sometimes they did as they pleased and assumed that God would help them anyway. Sometimes they demanded more now because they cared more about the immediate and pressing concerns of this world than they did about the promises of what was to come. Jesus was tested and he resisted. He was tempted as Israel was, yet without sin, without complaint, without compromise. But if you know your Bible well, you'll know that epic temptations come in sets of three, not pairs of two. There's still another picture in the very back of the attic, if you will. Only when we put that third picture with the other two have we properly assembled the work of the Master. What makes this third frame fit with the other two is not similarity of scene, but continuity in characters. You may remember or have noticed that in the wilderness temptation of Jesus, the second Adam, Satan is there in the foreground, but in the wilderness temptation of Israel, he's there, but we don't see him. He's in the background. But there's another temptation you remember, the first in human history. And the scene is different, but Satan is there, front and center, as is the first Adam and his wife. In a garden, Adam and Eve were confronted by a temptation, as it happens, about provision. Encouraged to think by Satan that God was not taking as good a care of them as he could, seeing that he was withholding from them something so appetizing. In that first temptation, they were encouraged by Satan to presumption, assuming that they could do the opposite of what God said and still come out okay in the end. ultimately they gave themselves to perversion. And that may be too soft of a word, not too hard. I mean, they were listening to the truth of God being twisted into a lie. They were choosing to follow the creature rather than the creator. They were putting Satan's word before God's, and then they made themselves their real authority in life as they chose to go their own way. And when Adam, whom one of the gospel writers also calls God's son, chose to twist the will of his Father in heaven, he sinned, and the world plunged into sin with him. I mentioned it's not enough to point out lessons that are to be learned from Matthew 4, because there are important biblical connections that we need to see in Matthew 4. But the most important reason why we need to move beyond the moral of the story is that there's a gospel to this story. In reading about the testing of God's son, Jesus, and then reflecting back on the testing of God's son, Israel, and then God's son, Adam, there's a message we must not miss. Remember, Adam was a representative man. And when our first parents failed their test, a kind of virus was unleashed that no one could escape. We're all left corrupted, left to ourselves. We all crash. After that, we only see failure replicated. Israel repeats Adam's failures. Eventually, as Adam was exiled from the Garden of Eden, they were exiled from the Promised Land. And it seems like testing, failure, exile is the only pattern we'll find in the Scriptures until we turn to the opening passages and chapters of the New Testament. And there we see another wilderness, another appearance of Satan, another test ordered by God. And here for the first time, where every mere mortal has failed, one man succeeds. And of course, that's just the beginning. My Bible, maybe yours, has this little heading that says, "The Temptation of Jesus." As if this were the only time Satan assailed our Lord. But unlike the temptation of Adam, and very much like the temptation of Israel in the wilderness, for most of the rest of Christ's life, Satan recedes into the background. But we see his handiwork everywhere. The whole of Christ's life is one characterized by conflict and adversity, and false accusation and rejection, each one a signature of Satan himself. And what are we to learn from that? Well, at the very least, Christians should learn from the resistance of our Savior, an example for ourselves. As one author put it, Christians must not go for a temporal kingdom, which Jesus refused. They must not grab fulfillment now, which Jesus declined. And they must not compromise with Satan, which Jesus rejected. They are to use the Spirit's sword in the ongoing battle against the forces of evil. Surely we're to see that he is our example. But much more than that, we need to see in these verses how it pictures Christ as our Savior. Because all that he did in our place and for our sakes. He came to face temptation as the last Adam. He came as a new representative who lived and obeyed and resisted temptation where we have not. As our substitute, he was earning for us a righteousness that we could never seem to acquire for ourselves. Just think about it. He fought compromise so that his steadfastness could be credited to us when we lack courage. He resisted easy prestige and privilege so that his kingdom perspective could be imputed to us when we are worldly and short-sighted. He turned to God for his provision so that his confidence could be ascribed to us when we worry. He carefully avoided presuming on his Father's kindness so that his wisdom and holiness could be counted ours when we are foolish and careless. He despised the perverted twisting of priorities that puts satanic suggestion at the same level as divine revelation. He resisted Satan so that all who trust in him will be completely and permanently forgiven for each and every time we have given in to the flesh, the world, and the devil. He was supplying the righteousness that comes to every justified sinner who is united to Christ by faith. That's good news. There's good news, gospel news, in Jesus crushing the Satan's temptations underfoot. Well, as I look back with you over these 11 verses, it seems that supernatural events are the most notable features of the chapter. I mean, where else do we encounter Satan at one end of a passage and angels at the other? Where else does the most sinful of all creatures guide the sinless Creator God from place to place? Where else do we read about a mountain where Jesus can see the whole world, or a conversation on some protrusion or pinnacle of the temple while priests and people mill about underneath, unaware of the drama going on overhead? Where else? And yet, perhaps the most remarkable feature of this chapter may be the thing that appears most normal: Jesus quoting Scripture. What could be more normal than that? And yet, when you think about it, isn't it astonishing? Is it not astonishing that after every assault, Jesus directs the attention of the devil to the book of Deuteronomy? I mean, that's amazing because as Matthew Henry's commentary notes, Jesus himself is the eternal word and could have produced the mind of God without having recourse, without turning to the writings of Moses. But who better than Jesus? Not only to know the Scripture, but to understand its power and authority. Who better than the incarnate Word of God to commend to us the written Word of God? We sometimes, I'm thinking, don't take the Bible seriously enough. But it was enough for Jesus that it is written. Do we need some better argument than he did? Is there something more profound or learned or clever that's required for us? Christianity's cultured despisers have long told us that it is absurd to be guided by this old book. But it was an old book already when Jesus was walking through the wilderness. And yet he quoted the Bible as if the Scriptures properly applied are a sufficient guide for every twist and turn in the most difficult of situations. I say properly applied because Satan shows he can understand, he can quote Scripture too. But he twists what is written. He takes a book from God and tries to use it against God. So Scripture must be understood well and used well. This is the time of year when we remember that Scripture was a battleground at the Reformation. And in fact, the necessity and the sufficiency of Scripture was a battle cry of the Reformers. It's interesting that those who opposed the Protestant Reformation were divided about Scripture. We can see that, for example, at the Council of Trent, a counter-Reformation gathering of the Roman Catholic Church. Of those who are willing to raise their voices and vote on the subject of Scripture, about three-quarters of them said that Scripture is equal to the traditions of the church. About a quarter of them said Scripture is similar to the authority of the traditions of the church. And then an uncooperative troika of men thought that the council should require people only to treat traditions with respect, but to treat Scripture with much more honor. But those in favor of reform in doctrine, by contrast, were united. In fact, the whole history of the Protestant Church, seen in hundreds of catechisms and confessions of the Church produced by Lutherans and Reformed alike, witnessed to the power and usefulness of the Scriptures, called the churches to be reformed according to the Scriptures. Yes, these confessions occasionally cite important authors in the history of the church. Protestant writers did and do so. But they understood that only Scripture contains the marks of necessity, sufficiency, clarity, and all that pertains to the gospel, and ultimate authority. Ultimately, the relevance, usefulness, truthfulness, and persuasiveness of any other book about God and the way of Scripture and the way of salvation pales in comparison with the Bible itself. But here I am pointing to different important authors and the Protestant tradition. How much more important it is this morning to see that the Bible speaks eloquently about itself and in a way that it does not speak about other books. The psalmist says once and again that God's word is light. The Proverbs teach us that the word of God is intended to give us wisdom and certainty. The epistle to the Romans teaches us that Scripture is there for our comfort. 2 Timothy 3 tells us that the Scriptures are useful for everything. Throughout the Scriptures, we're given any number of reasons why we should hold it dearly and trust it fully. Why we should view the Bible as a book without peers in literature, without colleagues. But I want you to see this morning that Matthew 4 especially directs our attention to the Bible as an aid, a sufficient and necessary aid in the fight against sin and temptation. In resisting Satan with Scripture, we find an example for all of us to follow. And prior to the Protestant Reformation, people often tried to fight Satan's evil with incantations and exorcisms, and many people still do today. Martin Luther began to see this as a problem. He certainly didn't get everything right, and he didn't even get everything about spiritual warfare right. For example, Luther blamed his astonishing digestive problems on the devil entirely. When a case could be made that if he had changed his diet, he would have done a lot better. But Satan does tempt God's people. Luther knew that. And he gradually began to deploy Scripture as the weapon of choice in fighting Satan's temptations. But why look at Luther? Why not look at Jesus? As John Calvin, another of the great reformers, once said, Christ uses Scripture as his shield. And then in a comment that would only work in the 16th century, he adds, those who voluntarily throw away that armor deserve to be strangled by Satan, into whose hands they give themselves up unarmed. I mentioned we need to know how to deal with the devil. The way we do that is with the Scriptures, to know the Scriptures, and to know how, like Jesus, to use those Scriptures. It's because the Bible is so effective, by the way, that Satan wants us to read it very little and then trust it even less. He wants us to be uncomfortable with the Bible, to airbrush the influence of the Bible out of our lives. He reminds us constantly that the Bible is offensive, irritating, and irrelevant to our unbelieving friends. He wants us to set it aside because he knows that the Word of God and good teaching from the Word of God is the life-giving power of God and the most effective weapon of the Spirit against every tool in the arsenal of Satan. And what's one of the most important things that the Bible has to say to us about this fight? It's that Jesus has already dealt the death blow, that he has crushed Satan's head. Our enemy wants us to feel hopeless about our sin. The Scriptures announce that Jesus has taken sin's penalty and has destroyed its final power. There's a point in World War II, and historians argue about when this point is. I think it's the Battle of Stalingrad. That's my opinion. There's a point when there's a turn, a pivot. And from that point forward, the Allies were emboldened in their fight because victory was virtually assured. The enemy had spread himself too thin beyond his resources. There comes a turning point in World War II when the Allied powers are fighting with courage, and the Axis powers realize they're fighting a war they could not win. Isn't that the war that our enemy is fighting? Especially since the battle at Calvary. We still fight, brothers and sisters. But we fight with the courage of those who know we will win. I said that in order to understand Matthew 4, we need to have not one, but three pictures in view. But even as I think with you this morning about Christ's victory, there are other sights that come to mind. We've spent this half hour really just looking at one wall of the gallery. But step back and look around and you'll see other scenes that the Holy Spirit has assembled in his special exhibit of saving revelation. Look with me at the end of Christ's ministry. There we see another temptation. Scripture presents before our eyes a scene from the Garden of Gethsemane with our Savior dreading the cup of wrath which he was going to drink down to its dregs. We see him again hanging on a cross, a spiritual wilderness of sorts, where he was more alone than ever before, but with crowds around him, testing him, tempting him. But thankfully, even that does not offer the full panorama, because after a dark portrait of a tomb, we see a scene of dazzling glory, of angels blinded by the guards of a grave that is now suddenly empty. And there is more. There's a long scene that begins at Pentecost and stretches the full length of the gallery. And in this scene, you see the apostles and the preachers. You see the praying men and women and children of the Middle Ages. You see the Protestant reformers and their followers. And if you look closely, you see insignificant people like you and me. All of us called to resist temptation. All of us called to trust in Christ and his sufferings and the abundance of his grace for our sin. All of us called to be part of a holy society that shows the kingdoms of the world God's glory. In short, all of us called to live by what is written. And at the end is a final scene. There we see Satan bound and then banished, never to tempt again. There we see the Son of God with angels around him and the world falling down before him. There we see the Church of Christ brought into glory. There we glimpse the elect from every nation, joining with those whose rest is won, finally doing to perfection what we have always only partly done. There we will worship the Lord our God, and him only will we serve. It's a glorious sight, almost too good to be true. So how do we know that all of this will come to pass? Because it is written. Let us pray. Father, equip us to fight temptation by trusting in our mighty Savior, who has overcome all. Teach us to know the Scriptures, to use wisely what is written for our defense and for the glory of your name and kingdom. We ask this, and then we are emboldened to ask even more. In spite of our weakness and the weakness of others whom we love and for whom we pray, we ask that your word would increase, that the number of your disciples would be multiplied greatly everywhere, and that the many who have struggles like our own would become obedient to the faith. We pray that you would fill us with your grace and power, so that no one will be able to withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which we speak. And in all of this, may your name be lifted high above us, as we ourselves recede into the crowd of your worshipers. It is in Jesus' name that we ask these things. Amen.